I think we don't need much of introduction. He is a well-known personality. Let me just briefly introduce Dr. Rakesh Mohan. He is currently the executive director at the International Monetary Fund, Washington, representing India, Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, and Bhutan since 1st November 2012. Dr. Rakesh Mohan was a deputy governor of the Reserve Bank of India from September 2002 to October 2004. And from July 2005 to June 2009. In the interim period from October 2004 to June 2005, he was the Secretary, Department of Economic Affairs, Minister of Finance, Government of India. Until recently, Dr. Rakesh Mohan was the Chairman, National Transport Development Policy Committee, Government of India, in the rank of a Minister of State. In addition, he was a Vice Chairman, Indian Institute of Human Settlements, proposed to be India's first independently funded and managed interdisciplinary national university for research and innovation that is committed to the equitable, sustainable, and efficient transformation of Indian settlements. He was also a non-resident senior research fellow of Stanford Center for International Development, Stanford University. Including the position of Chief Economic Advisor, Minister of Finance, he has held many responsible higher positions of the statutory bodies of Government of India. Prior to his current position at the IMF, Dr. Mohan was professor in the practice of International Economics of Finance, the School of Management, and Senior Fellow, Jackson Institute of Global Affairs, Yale University, from July 2010. Dr. Mohan has researched extensively in the areas of economic reforms and liberalization, industrial economics, urban economics, infrastructure studies, economic regulation, monetary policy, and the financial sector. He is the author of 3 books on urban economics and urban developments, co-author of 1 and editor of another on Indian economic policy reforms, and author of 2 books on monetary policy and central banking, and of numerous articles. Dr. Mohan obtained his BSc degree in electrical engineering from Imperial College, University of London, and BA degree from the Yale University. He obtained his PhD in economics from Princeton University, USA. So without taking much of time, I now invite Dr. Mohan to make his presentation on monetary policy coordination and role of central banks. Dr. Mohan.
Thank you very much, Dr. Varasinghe, for a very kind introduction. I'm very pleased to have this opportunity now to represent Sri Lanka in the IMF. I last was here, I think, about 9 years ago in this very hall. And in fact, I had a double bill last time, which is that I gave a lecture in the afternoon and my wife danced, did a Bharatanatyam performance in the evening in this very lecture, in this very theater. So I'm really pleased to be back here again. Unfortunately, my wife is not with me this time. Otherwise, you could have actually omitted the lecture and she could have performed and you would have found that more interesting, perhaps. As you know, there's a new discussion currently going on the possible need for monetary policy coordination among central banks, and many different views.
Did I do something?
Many different views have been expressed on the need for monetary policy coordination and, of course, the opposite views. So what I thought that I would do is to first introduce the issue. Why has this issue arisen now, which is basically to do with monetary policy in advanced economies, and perhaps greater integration, greater financial integration, global financial integration across the world, so that what advanced economies do affect the rest of the world, and hence the need for monetary policy coordination. Then talk about the scope and feasibility of such coordination, how what might be the context of such coordination, and then also that if there isn't such coordination, what is it that central banks and emerging markets economies can do. The issue has arisen in recent months, recent last couple of years, really as a consequence of the highly accommodative monetary policies of advanced economies since 2008, both conventional policies and unconventional policies. And now, in fact, the IMF even has a spillover report, which is issued every year. And it has what the unconventional policies in advanced economies and the highly accommodative monetary policies have resulted in very volatile capital flows. As you might recall, some 2-3 years back, the finance minister of Brazil, Mr. Guido Mantega, had talked about currency wars, because obviously if a dominant economy brings the interest rate route to zero, then it has an impact on exchange rates also. And so he had then really started this debate talking about currency wars. And for emerging market economies, of course, it then results in issues to do with macroeconomic and financial stability. Now, looking at the role of central banks in advanced economies, there are obviously different views on the desirability first, second, feasibility also, that even if you agree that it's desirable to have monetary policy coordination, is it feasible? To some extent, however, this is not a new issue. After the fiscal stimulus, after the Lehman collapse, there was a good deal of cooperation among countries, although not in monetary policy per se, but on a coordinated fiscal stimulus that took place after the Lehman collapse in September 2008, partly through the G20 framework. We have had policy coordination through the Basel process for 20 years, through Basel 1, 2, 3 now. Also, earlier the Financial Stability Forum was formed, which was mainly among advanced economies. After the Lehman collapse in 2008, the Financial Stability Board was then founded. The Financial Stability Forum was transformed into Financial Stability Board in the summit of, was it April 2009, the G20 summit that took place in London at that time. And the Financial Stability Board was formed, which then expanded the Financial Stability Forum membership from advanced economies to also including the larger G20 economies. And then, of course, even much earlier, if you go back to the 70s, there were the Louvre and Plaza Accords on coordinated exchange rate intervention. There are many other examples. So the point I'm just making is that as at different times problems have arisen in the world, there has been cooperation among central banks and financial regulatory authorities when it really affects the advanced economies themselves. There aren't really many examples of coordination taking place when problems affect emerging market economies. The RBI governor, Dr. Raghuram Rajan, was here, was it last week, isn't it? And he gave also a talk here. He has, in some sense, led the discussion on this since early this year when he gave a talk at Brookings Institution on monetary cooperation. And he has, of course, given the view that policy cooperation has broken down. He has argued very strongly that the U.S. should worry about the effects of its policies in the rest of the world. In the talk that he gave at Brookings in April of this year, Ben Bernanke had just joined Brookings, having stepped down from having finished his term at the U.S. Federal Reserve. He was in the front row of the audience when Raghu gave this address. And he gave a very strong response countering him. But Dr. Rajan has argued very strongly that given the financial integration in the world, that we would like to live in a world where countries take into account the effect, particularly the larger countries, take into effect take into account the effect of their policies and on other countries and do what is right broadly rather than what is just right given the circumstances of their own country. And the point is that if even a large country like India does something as monetary policy, its economy is still not large enough to affect a good deal of the rest of the world. But the Eurozone, the United States, possibly Japan, what they do does affect the rest of the world, so they do need to have some effect. They do need to take into account what their policies, what kind of effects their policies have. To just give one example on the different views, there are many examples. I've just picked up one from Deputy Governor Carina Ekholm from the Swedish Central Bank. And she has basically argued that she does agree that more expansionary policy in the Eurozone does lead to an impact in a country like Sweden, which is not in the Eurozone. And because of very low interest rates in the Eurozone, the Swedish central bank can't do anything very different. So it can lead to excessive indebtedness in Swedish households, an example of spillover from large economies on small open economies. But at the same time, she then argues that what will benefit the Swedish economy much more is rapid recovery in the euro area, and so that if the expansionary monetary policy in the euro area results in greater expansion and faster recovery in the euro area, that's good for the Swedish economy. And then she goes on to argue that the negative effects that it might have on the Swedish economy should really be dealt through macroprudential policies, which in Sweden would be done by the government and not by the central bank. So I'm just giving one example, but here's a deputy governor of a central bank in a relatively small advanced economy who agrees that there are spillovers, but then argues that, in fact, still there's no need for the larger country to take account of what happens to the smaller country, and the smaller country can take care of the ill effects through macroprudential policies rather than monetary policy. So I've just given a very brief snapshot of the issue, the kind of discussions that are going on, and as I said, there are many other discussions that you could actually have a look. Now, I will now sort of review what has actually happened in the last 6 years or so. That the advanced economy central bank interest rate actions have essentially been largely uncoordinated. But one thing what you observe in this chart, I'm not sure if the colors are coming out reasonably. So the green is the US policy rate. And one thing you can see is how it has gone up and down since 2000. And what you also see very interestingly is that the other countries, other large, other advanced economies, the Eurozone and the UK, the euro area is the blue, and the UK is the red, have responded with a lag. So you can sort of see reasonably clearly that what the US does, then the rest of the world, the larger advanced economies, still follow. The one time there was explicit coordination was immediately after the Lehman collapse on October 8, 2008, when there was indeed a coordinated reduction of 25 to 50 basis points by six advanced economy central banks in order to ease global monetary conditions because of the real threat of a global financial meltdown. So again, the point is that even though generally it's been uncoordinated, when there was a real problem, the advanced economy central banks did get together and take coordinated monetary policy action at the same time. There have also been some earlier occasions of coordinated action by the G7 countries, first in response to the 1987 stock market crash, And then, of course, what I mentioned earlier, even earlier in the 70s, the exchange rate interventions in a coordinated fashion after the Plaza and Louvre Accords. And once again, making the point that when issues affect the advanced economies themselves, they do get together and coordinate it. Then they don't argue that, look, my job is only to look at my own economy. Second, that there was the one kind of effective coordination that did take place after the Lehman collapse was the US dollar liquidity swaps offered by the Federal Reserve, first to the G7, but then also some of the emerging markets like Korea, Singapore, Mexico, and Brazil. And you can see that the liquidity swaps that offered by the Federal Reserve were huge immediately after the Lehman collapse. And there was a similar, swaps that were offered. Again, there was a blip in late 2011, early 2012, when the euro area sovereign debt concerns arose. After the liquidity swaps that were offered by the Federal Reserve in late 2008, after Lehman, among the Eurozone and a number of other advanced economy central banks, it's now become a permanent facility from the U.S. Federal Reserve, not to the emerging markets, but it's now become a permanent facility among the advanced economy central banks. So again, that's an example of coordinated action that has indeed taken place. Now, in terms of unconventional actions, which have also been uncoordinated, you can see here that as a consequence of the quantitative easing that the United States has undertaken, the Bank of England has undertaken, their central bank balance sheets have gone up by a factor of 3 to 4. Today, the size of the Federal Reserve balance sheet is about 3.5 times what it was before the Lehman crisis. The Bank of England balance sheet has gone up by a factor of 300%. Swiss National Bank has gone up by a factor of 3. But in the case of Swiss National Banks, it's not really QE. It's that they decided to put a floor under the exchange rate, ceiling on the exchange rate, because it was appreciating excessively against the euro area because of the safe haven status of Switzerland. And so since then, basically, they have been just buying up foreign exchange to protect the Swiss exchange from appreciating so much, and as a consequence, their balance sheet has increased by a factor of 3. The Bank of Japan has gone up by 100%, euro, the ECB by about 50%. And you can see on the other chart, on the right-hand side, central bank balance sheets, the way they've gone up as a percentage of GDP. And once again, huge increases in the size of the balance sheets because of the unconventional monetary policy action in terms of the QE that they have done in buying up both U.S. treasuries and other securities, mortgage securities, etc. But the consequence of this, of course, this huge quantitative expansion and very, very low interest rates, extended zero interest rate policy, there have indeed been large spillovers to emerging markets and volatile capital flows and exchange rates. And that's really the key issue. This is something that I think all of us are familiar with, so I don't need to spend much time on it, but it has resulted in volatile capital flows, volatile exchange rates, volatile current accounts, also asset price inflation, which actually is global, boom in credit and monetary aggregates, also that when there's easy monetary policy and low interest rates in advanced economies, the emerging markets also have to bring down their interest rates because otherwise they'll get even more capital flows. And this has given rise to increased risks in monetary and financial stability. Now, one of the things, in fact, you can observe, even going back to something like 30 years, I had the privilege of chairing a working group for the Bank for International Settlements, the Committee for the Global Financial System, CGFS, in 2006, 2007 to 9 on global capital flows. And there, in fact, we had found a certain degree of association between financial crisis and turmoil that we experienced in emerging markets since the early 80s, having some relationship with essentially U.S. monetary policy, so that when U.S. monetary policy was tightened, interest rates went up. There was coincidence of Latin American debt crisis. I'm not seeing a one-to-one correspondence, but a reasonable degree of correspondence that whenever there's tightening, whenever there's loosening, there's excess capital flows, asset price booms, greater borrowing by the emerging markets during the easy monetary policy period. When the monetary policy then gets tightened, the reverse takes place and they undergo crises. It happened in the 80s in Latin America, in Asia in the mid to late 90s, and then, of course, the kind of turmoil we've been experiencing the last few years. I want to emphasize that I'm not saying that's the only cause, because obviously it's always there's some problem in the emerging market itself which gets exacerbated by the changes in volatility monetary policy in advanced economies. And, of course, the most recent example was what is now termed the U.S. taper tantrum last May, when there was just an indication by the U.S. Federal Reserve, Ben Bernanke, the chairman, on the possibility of doing a taper, and there was large volatility that took place as a consequence. Just giving a little bit of an overview in terms of spillovers to emerging markets, what is very interesting is if you go back 100 years, the global capital market was most open as it is now prior to World War I. But there was an anchor, and that was the gold standard, which kept exchange rates stable. And as I said, financial openness was comparable to the modern era, and there was huge amount of inflows and outflows for the 30, 40 years preceding World War I. But the anchor was the gold standard, and so exchange rates didn't move very much. Between World War I and World War II, the international monetary system broke down, and then as a consequence, the open global capital market got fragmented, and that's when all the capital controls went up, and there was really no anchor in the world between the two world wars. And that's when, of course, as a consequence, the IMF and the World Bank were founded, and the system that the Bretton Woods institutions put in, basically the IMF, was that we moved from the absolute fixed exchange rate that was the gold standard to partially fixed exchange rates, in the sense that then in the Bretton Woods system between the Second World War and 1971, that exchange rates were fixed to the dollar, but dollar was pegged to gold. But the idea was that countries could actually adjust their exchange rates in response to current account problems. And there was no. And during the Bretton Woods period, it was the capital accounts were generally not open, and that was part of the system. The problem that took place, of course, in the Bretton Woods system was that even though ex ante it had been expected that the exchanges would be adjusted with the permission of the IMF when there were problems, but in practice that didn't happen because there was stigma associated with doing a large depreciation and devaluation. So the system then broke down in the early 70s. And we then, after 1971, but especially after 1980s, we moved to floating exchange rates, more and more opening of capital accounts, and of course in the 70s this was accompanied by the oil price crisis of 1973. There was a huge recycling of petrodollars and Latin American debt. So in fact, what happened is that as the oil countries accumulated excess dollars, basically in U.S. banks, that the U.S. banks and on-lent those dollars to Latin America. And then 10 years later, of course, the Latin American debt crisis took place. And so there were both push and pull factors for large flows then taking to emerging markets, emerging and developing economies at that time in that period. Now, again, that's a very quick history of what happened. The point I'm just making is that it is since the it is since the Bretton Woods system broke down and floating exchange rates became the norm and capital accounts became open that you've had this volatility in capital flows with the attendant problems that have arisen since then. I'm now going to give you some charts to give you some idea of the kind of volatility that we've had. The colors in your screen are better than the colors in my screen, so a little difficult for me to look at these colors. But basically, what I want to show here is, if you look on the left-hand panel, left-hand chart, that two, three things we need to point out. First, that the top line is the total private flows on a net basis. And you can see how the volume has gone up since 1980, since the global capital markets started becoming more and more open. Second thing I want you to notice is that the blue lines, the blue bars, are FDI, direct investment. And you can see very clearly that the FDI is much more stable. And it's not been subject to a great deal of fluctuation. What is most unstable are both other private, there's bank flows, and second, and portfolio flows. Portfolio flows are the green bars, and the other flows, which are basically banking flows, debt flows, are the green, are the red bars. So you can see that the real volatility that takes place is through portfolio debt flows and through banking debt flows. And to some extent, that gives us, those of us in emerging markets who have to manage these things, to understand that FDI is much more stable, and but we need to be careful about both portfolio debt flows as also bank external borrowing. The right-hand chart is the same thing except expressed as a percentage of GDP. This chart perhaps is a bit too complicated, so I won't spend much time on it. But it's the same chart, except that I've now shown here the different regions in the world. The largest flows, as you might expect, of course, are flows to Asia, which are the red lines. But the picture is not clear enough for you to see the difference, so but don't bother about it. One other issue that's of great interest is that you look at the capital inflows from non-residents and outflows from residents separately. So that the outflows by residents is the red and the inflows net by non-residents is the green. As you can see that the capital, the volatility in capital inflows from non-residents has been much higher than the outflows from residents. And once again, the left-hand chart is in billion dollars and the right-hand one is in per capita, sorry, it is percent of GDP. And this is on a month, these are monthly basis. And what basically this shows is that the bond flows are much more volatile than the equity flows. And again, this is very important because there's been a great deal of advocacy that after the Latin American debt crisis and also the Asian crisis, in some sense, we had all agreed that it was original sin to borrow in foreign currency for emerging market or developing countries. Now, one of the things that you see here is that, as a consequence, there's been a great deal of advocacy from analysts, economists, and also international institutions, that we need to open up our domestic bond markets to foreign and portfolio investors so that we don't have the exchange risk and that the foreign investors invest in our own currencies, and that is less risky. But we need to have some pause or think about that, because the highest volatility is indeed in the debt flows into our own currencies. And to some extent, what happened after the taper tantrum last year was a major outflow from the domestic debt markets. One other thing that as a consequence of the highly accommodative monetary policy of the United States, that you can see that after 2008, the net international debt issuance by emerging market countries and developing countries has gone up tremendously, and particularly in the last couple of years, to the extent that there's oversubscription to bonds issued by even African countries like Rwanda and Kenya and others. I don't mean any disrespect to those countries, but purely to illustrate that because of the excessive low interest rates in advanced economies, there's a huge search for yield, and therefore people are taking much more risk, and given the loose monetary policy, given excess liquidity, that those flows are then going off to a large number of countries, including very risky countries, which otherwise wouldn't get these flows. And when the reversal takes place, you will see that the reversal in capital flows with the attendant problems. One other very important point to understand, which is often overlooked, is here you see the blue, difference between the gross inflows and net inflows. The left-hand side shows gross inflows, and the right-hand side shows net inflows. That gross inflows are much greater than net inflows. So I know for India, for example, these, of course, are global numbers. For advanced, the blue is the advanced economies, and the red is the emerging markets. That 2 points to note here. As you can see, that among the characteristics of what led to 2008 crisis was among advanced economies, that between around 2000 and 2008, the gross inflows among advanced economies went up from around 2 trillion a year to something like 10 trillion a year. So with the post the dot-com crash, when the U.S. monetary policy became highly accommodative and there was a huge search for yield, there was a huge amount of money sloshing around among advanced economies. And on the right-hand chart that you see that even, say, 2008, the net inflow, it has the blue numbers, was only about 500 billion as opposed to 10 trillion floating around in terms of in and out. So you need to understand that we need to look at both gross flow numbers, because on a day-to-day basis, because when you look at these numbers, we are netting up, we're taking it the whole year. But on a day-to-day basis, it could be the case that there's no net inflow on the year as a whole, but there are large gross inflow volatility on a day-to-day or a week-to-week basis, which affects the movement of exchange rates. So we need to be to understand that as we open our capital accounts, that we need to be sure that either we are able to manage that kind of volatility, or that our markets are developed enough to manage that kind of volatility. This is a similar chart, same chart as the last one, except this is expressed as a percentage of GDP, so that you see that the gross flows among advanced economies in 2008 had reached something like 25% of GDP of the advanced economy. So it was huge sloshing of capital that was happening before the crisis, and then you can see how it just absolutely, the blue line tells you here, the global financial collapse that took place after Lehman. It's a very graphic description of why there was that huge panic and then the consequence of the panic. The way the financial markets react is when something happens, they just collapse. And that has happened in 2008, and it's been taken a long time for them to recover. And of course, in some sense, fortunately, we have not come back to the kind of volumes that we had at that time. This chart just show you the the kind of fluctuations that have taken place in exchange rates as a consequence of these large volatility in capital flows. And then this chart now shows you that prior to 2008, there was, on the one side, the United States had developed a large current account deficit of over 5% of GDP. On the other side, China had, of course, developed a large current account surplus. And what has happened now is that as a consequence of the crisis, that the developing economies and emerging markets have adjusted, but they have now gone into current account deficits. And that's a mirror of the capital account flows that have taken place as a search for yield. And therefore, you start becoming more vulnerable. And that's what happened to India last year, that as our current account deficit increased to something like 4% of GDP. And incidentally, the IMF in the previous year had in their in their external sector report had opined, according to all their modeling and research that they had done, that 4% of GDP current account deficit for India was appropriate, and that is what was would be a stable current account deficit, and then, so that you can then benefit from net capital flows from abroad for investment, etc. Once the taper tantrum took place, and there was the instability last year that India experienced, then the IMF said it's happening because you have unsustainable current account deficit. The current account deficit is too large. So the point is that we need to be careful about what we do ourselves. I'm speaking, even though I'm speaking as an IMF executive director, I say the same things on the board, that look, you need to be careful on how you do your calculations, how you advise, because then countries have this consequence. Then you come around and say that you're a member of the Fragile Five. This is what they said last year when the taper tantrum took place. But the point of this chart essentially is that after the crisis, with the extended zero interest rate policy and the accommodative monetary policy and the unconventional policy of QE, capital flows have increased to emerging markets. And of course, the reflection is also in negative current account deficits. And what has also happened at the same time is that Germany now is the largest surplus country. I had earlier done a very quick history of the international monetary system, and one of the very interesting charts that some of the interesting data that you find is a hugely increased incidence of financial crisis post the Bretton Woods system of open capital accounts. So during the most stable period in terms of crises was the Bretton Woods period from 1948 to 1972. The interwar period, of course, was unstable. And since post-Bretton Woods, 1973 to 2010, the incidence of crises have gone up significantly. And that is what we've been experiencing for the last 30 years. And again, all of this goes to show that with this kind of instability, that you need to be thinking more about monetary policy coordination and issue of capital account openness. We've talked about the taper tantrum last year, that one of the consequences of that is that the projection of growth of emerging markets from the IMF has gone down subsequent to the taper tantrum. This is again to show that as a consequence of volatility, the impact of monetary policy changes in the dominant advanced economies, there's a real impact in terms of the expectation of growth coming down. So it's not just any theoretical kind of discussion, that what people had thought as an expectation of growth prior to the taper tantrum has came down significantly post facto. I talked about the impact on India, that you see here two episodes. First, the 2008 crisis, when very significant portfolio outflows took place, and then even greater, the taper tantrum last year, when there was a huge outflow took place from India, with the resulting consequence on the impact on the exchange rate we see on the right-hand panel. Again, basically pointing out the consequence of advanced economy actions, monetary policy actions, on what happens to countries like ours. So I burdened you with a number of charts, basically to illustrate the point that there is this general issue of international monetary. Why are we talking about international monetary coordination? Why is Dr. Rajan talking about international policy coordination? It is because of the kind of developments that have taken place, not just the last 5 years, but certainly particularly the last 5 years, but really over a period of 30 years, that as you have greater global financial integration, as you have more open capital accounts, as our economies become more open, as we all get more integrated with the rest of the world, there will be these kind of consequences of what happens in dominant economies, and therefore we need to think about international monetary coordination. Now, there are different arguments, there are different views here. Someone like Professor John Taylor of Stanford, his view, of course, is that there's no need for coordination if everyone follows the same monetary policy rule, like, of course, the Taylor rule. But as a counter to that, the point is that even if we follow something like a Taylor rule, large spillovers will result in large fluctuations in exchange rates and interest rates in our countries. So it's not clear how his solution is a good one for us. Among different observers, people like Dr. Rajan, Professor Eichengreen, Professor William Bouter, they do believe that advanced economy central banks need to take cognizance of spillovers of their policies. Of course, US Federal Reserve, many other academics in advanced countries believe the opposite. The view, in some sense, also by other academics is that the volatility in emerging markets is caused by their own policies, not by emerging market, not by advanced economies. And it is basically an outcome, and there's a slightly different kind of view from someone like Danny Roderick, that it's an outcome of the emerging market, developing economies' misplaced embrace of financial globalization. That in some sense, he's arguing that why have we listened to all the advocates of financial openness and capital account openness? Well, if that's what you do, you deserve what you get. It's your misplaced embrace of financial globalization. The IMF chief economist, Olivier Blanchard, on international policy coordination, he says it's like the Loch Ness Monster, an issue that is much discussed but rarely seen, that is international policy coordination. So there is, I would say, a good discussion going on at present among different people with different views. What do the advanced economy policymakers say? That, look, the Federal Reserve Chairman says, that, look, my chairperson says that my mandate is management of domestic inflation and output. My mandate does not say, the mandate I've been given by the US Congress does not say that I have to think about the rest of the world. So don't expect me to do it. And second, of course, he says, well, it's difficult for me to also figure out that even if I did worry about what happened to the rest of the world, what would I do about it? And I think there is something to be said for that. What can she actually do if she does worry about the rest of us? But at the same time, it is the case that, as I've demonstrated, that US monetary policy does have large spillovers to the rest of the world, and especially to emerging market countries. What are the suggestions that people have given? There was a committee, there was a group under the Brookings banner, which was led by Professor Barry Eichengreen of Berkeley. It also had Raghuram Rajan on it and about 10 other very prominent people. They talked about the possibility of international monetary policy committee. The question is, will it work? How will such an international monetary policy committee be formed? How will the views of central banks, advanced economies, and emerging markets get factored in such a committee? Is not clear at all, but that is something that they had advocated in a paper. It is an excellent paper called Rethinking Central Banking, which you'll be able to find on the Brookings website. Further, advanced economy policymakers are also agnostic about the spillovers. The general argument is really similar to the one that I had shown earlier from the Swedish Central Bank, which is that net-net, unconventional monetary policy or extended zero interest rate policy or extended accommodative monetary policy, because it is beneficial for global growth as a whole, that if we didn't do that accommodative monetary policy, if we didn't have extended zero interest rate policy, if we didn't do QE, the world would be worse off because the recovery won't take place in the dominant advanced economies, and therefore net-net emerging markets gain from that. And here's a quote from Ben Bernanke. And then the question is, well, if that is true, then what do we do about it? Is there any role for the IMF? One thing, of course, the IMF does all the time is analysis and surveillance. It does what you call multilateral surveillance to twice yearly World Economic Outlook, the Global Financial Stability Report. But there are some issues to do with objectivity and even-handedness. So what is it, having gone through all that, what is it that we can do? What are the options? One option is capital account management. There's a huge number of research papers trying to find the consequence or the benefits that countries get from open capital accounts. What is very interesting is that obviously in theory, there's a reasonable ground to say that countries with open capital accounts benefit. But there's very weak empirical evidence that have been found for it across the board. What are the issues here? One, that generally speaking, with higher growth in emerging markets and higher inflation, the average inflation, say, for the last 15 years or thereabouts in emerging markets has been something like 3% higher than inflation in advanced economies. And hence, interest rates are higher than advanced economies. And therefore, if you have an open capital account, there's a huge likelihood of arbitrage. If you have higher nominal interest rates, which you will, because you have characteristically higher inflation, characteristically higher growth, and therefore attraction for flows to come in. The problem with that is that when the arbitrage takes place because of higher nominal interest rates, and as more flows, in theory, the exchange rate should adjust for the differential inflation, but in practice what happens is that as you get more capital flows, the opposite takes place, the exchange rate depreciates. And therefore, that's an intrinsic problem on having an open capital account in emerging market economy, a totally open capital account. Also, as I've demonstrated, free open capital account implies too much volatility, particularly in debt flows and other portfolio flows. And therefore, one solution to this problem of high volatile capital flows is really capital account management. Note that I'm saying capital account management, not capital controls. In my view, capital controls are a subset of capital account management. There are many different ways of doing capital account management. But this is an open issue on how much capital account management you should do. The point that Dr. Raghuram Rajan makes is, when arguing for international monetary policy coordination, the point that he makes is that, look, if you don't do monetary policy coordination, you're pushing me to do capital account management. You're pushing me to do capital controls. Is it a good idea to not do international monetary policy coordination and push me to do capital controls so that then there's global financial disintegration? And I think that's a very important issue to be debated, that is it better, that is it the case that if there isn't international monetary policy education, international monetary policy coordination, the emerging markets are pushed to managing their capital accounts, and therefore have global financial disintegration. In terms of the role, then there's the second option, that we accept that there's volatility, but we realize that, well, there are backstops available, and there is an IMF available to help countries which then get in trouble because of volatility. The problem, to some extent, is that the IMF quota resources, and the quota resources here are in the blue line, the total resources are the red dotted line. The difference between the total resources and the quota resources is the rest of the stuff is borrowed money by the IMF. Quota resources is what all countries contribute as their quotas into the IMF. The other resources are less permanent because they're borrowed for certain periods of time. And particularly this went up as a consequence of the 2008 crisis, that when the G20 met in London in the summit in April 2009, then there was general agreement to increase IMF resources, and there were new lines of borrowing that IMF did. So what you can see here in the right-hand panel is that the quota resources have really come down as a proportion of global GDP. And therefore, there is an issue of, does the International Monetary Fund have enough resources to be able to act as a stabilizing mechanism in the international monetary policy, in the international monetary system? Third, one of the consequences of the IMF's resources coming down as a proportion of global GDP is that we now have increasing number of regional financial arrangements. First is Chiang Mai arrangement, which is now up to $240 billion, basically among Asian countries, ASEAN plus three. Then there was the European Stability Mechanism, which came up after the European crisis, about €500 billion. And of course, the latest is the currency reserve arrangement among the BRICS, about $100 billion. And there's also an exploding number of bilateral arrangements. Japan, India, China, ECB, China, Bank of England, China, Swiss National Bank. There's huge number, increasing number of bilateral swap arrangements among central banks as a consequence of this greater volatility and the reduction in the monetary power of the IMF. So the point basically is that there has been a large increase in volatility as a consequence of advanced economy monetary policy actions. It is causing difficulties in overall macro management, leading to crises in emerging markets. There are basically two options, that either we have more international monetary policy coordination, the lines of which are unclear, or that emerging markets are left to their own devices, that if the advanced economies say, look, we have to worry about ourselves, we should say we have to worry about ourselves and do capital account management. And third, and this is the kind of thing that Dr. Rajan has been advocating, is a more organized system of swaps, so that we recognize that this volatility takes place. When there is such volatility, it's not a solvency issue, but a liquidity issue, that if there are easy swap lines available from the advanced economy central banks, then we don't need to go to the IMF, we don't need to have conditionality. Automatically, certain swaps under certain conditions take place, and so that's an alternative also that can be considered. Thank you very much.